So let us continue with our discussion on RNA processing. Yesterday, we discussed the RNA processing methods, including the splicing mechanisms of group 1 and group 2 introns. Now, we are going to discuss the splicing mechanism based on spliceosome formation or spliceosomal introns. And briefly, I listed the different type of snRNAs and snRNPs, which is involved in the formation of the spliceosomal complex. That is. Spliceosomal complex that is used for the third type of splicing mechanism, that is a spliceosome-mediated splicing. Here we can see that the exons in the screen, you can see that the exons, two different exons were represented with the green color. The first one is here and the second one is here, and the yellow region that is shown in this picture is an intron that needs to be removed using the splicing mechanism. This intron, which is a spliceosomal intron, will have two different types of endpoints or end sequences. Yesterday we discussed that one also. Here we have an intron with the GU and AG ends. Okay. So the 5' end of the intron is having a GU, and the 3' end of the intron is having an AG sequence. Now in this case, the first snRNA that is attached to this intron sequence is U1. So the U1 snRNA is having a complementary sequence to this particular region of the, or the 5' region of the intron. So the U1 RNA, which is having a complementary sequence to the 5' end of the intron, will form a pairing, and that U1 will bind to this region, including the 5' GU region. So that is the first step. And then comes the U2 snRNA. That U2 snRNA will also have a complementary sequence, which will pair with the some sequences in the, or some internal sequences of the intron, and that sequence of the intron is having an additional A or an A, a particular A residue, which is present inside that intron sequence. So covering this intron sequence, we will have a complementary sequence in the intron, which will be corresponding to the, or which will be complementary to the U2 snRNA. So the U2 snRNA will pair with this region of the intron with a complementary base pairing. So that's the two steps that is occurring in the initial step of the spliceosomal intron base mediated splicing. So you can read this one. The RNA pairing interactions in the formation of spliceosomal complexes is shown here. The first step is the U1 snRNA as a sequence near its 5' end. So this is the U1 RNA, and this is the 5' end of the U1 RNA. So the sequences at the 5' end of the U1 RNA is complementary to the splice site at the 5' end of the intron. So this is the 5' end of the intron, and this will be complementary to the 5' end sequence of the intron. The base pairing of the U1 to this region of the primary transcript helps define the 5' splice site during the spliceosome assembly. So this binding of U1 to this particular region defines or marks the 5' splice site. So this is where you need to splice the intron. That is marked using this U1. The U2 is paired to the intron at a position encompassing the A residue. So the U2 will pair similarly, encompassing or covering the A residue, which is present or represented here. And that becomes the nucleophile during the splicing reaction. So what is the importance of this A residue? This A residue is used as a nucleophile in the splicing reaction. And you know that this splicing A residue is functioning as a nucleophile similar to the nucleophile reactions in the group 1 and group 2 intron splicing, which will, well, the nucleophile will provide a free OH group, which is supposed to bond with the 5'-phosphate group of the concerned end. Okay, if it is acting on the 5' end of the intron, then the 5' phosphate group and this guanine residue will have to, or it is supposed to pair with the OH group, which is provided by this nucleophile, so that it will form, say, a lariat or ring-like structure. So this is the region of the nucleophile, which is sponsored by the A residue, and the U1 will pair, marking that region or covering that region. Okay, so the base pairing of the U2 is an RNA causes a bulge in the splice. So once it is paired, it will create a bulge, or that particular A residue will be bulged outside that structure, so that it will be freely available to pair with this one. So the structural change by binding of the U2 in the intron will project the A to the outside region, so that the OH group or the nucleophile group will be free to attack the GU or the 5' end of the intron. So the structural change that is created by the U2 binding will result in the bulging of the A to the outside region and making available the OH group, which is ready to pair with the 5' phosphate group. That's it. And then the base pairing of the U2 snRNA causes a bulge that displaces and helps to activate the adenylate, whose second OH will form a lariat structure or a ring-like structure through a 2' or 2', 5' phosphodiester bond. Here you may note that this is the 2', because this is an RNA and an internal residue like A, which is represented here, will have only the second OH or 2' OH that is free to perform a nucleophilic attack, because it is 2' or 2' OH is already used in forming the RNA phosphodiester bond. So the only thing that is available in an internal nucleotide in an RNA structure is the 2' OH of the RNA or the ribose. So that 2' OH of this adenine will perform a nucleophilic attack on the 5' phosphate group of the guanine. So that is the 2', 5' phosphodiester bond that is formed between the A residue and the guanine, which will result in a ring-like structure. We'll see it later. Okay, now when we come to the details of the binding of the snRNPs, here, this is the DNA, this is the RNA polymerase, and the RNA polymerase is actually creating the mRNA or primary transcript, which is represented here. And in this primary transcript, initially, at the 5' end of the intron, the U1 snRNP will bind, which is actually mentioned here. This process will occur here, U1 snRNP. Then the internal nucleophile A covering that region will be bound with the U2 snRNP. So this is it. So whenever you are representing an snRNP, U1 or U2, you will have two components. This is the protein component, and there will also be an snRNA or RNA structure, which is represented in between. So here You can see the RNA, which is actually embedded in the protein structure. And the complementary sequence of this RNA will bind with the newly created or newly synthesized primary transcript. So always the snRNB is having two components. One is a protein component and an RNA component. So that's an snRNB. So human snRNB is having its own protein part and RNA part. The RNA part is complementary to the concerned region in the primary transcript where it binds. So here also we have an RNA structure and also a protein structure, which constitutes the U2 snRNP, and the complementary region of the RNA or snRNA will bind with the primary transcript, or it will pair with the primary transcript as shown here. Okay. So this is the binding of U1 and U2, and the 3' splice site will be ahead or downstream. So this is the 3' splice site. And even before the complete synthesis of the 3' splice site, the U1 and U2 will bind, because RNA synthesis is occurring along with the splicing mechanisms. So what happens is that the U1 and U2 will bind even before the complete synthesis or termination of the RNA primary transcript production. So the 3' splice site will be here, which will be synthesized downstream later by the time U1 and U2 will bind. Then at the 3' splice site, there we have the U5 snRNP, which is bound. So when the 3' splice site emerges from the primary transcription complex, or where the transcription is actually reaching its termination point, then 3' splice. Yes, sir, okay.
Sir, Anjali couldn't able to attend the class. Sir?
Okay, admit it.
Okay.
It's done. Thank you.
Okay, sir.
Okay, fine. So here, the next step is the binding of the U5 snRNP at the 3' splice site, or at the end region. So this is the 3' splice site. And at the third step, the U5 snRNP is binding at the 3' end, or which is here. And now in the second diagram, you can see that U5 snRNB is bound at the 3' splice site. So U1, U2, and U5 binds. Then comes the U5 and U6 snRNB, which is a complex, which is used to form, or the loop that is created will be around the U1, U4 and U6. So finally, you will have another complex of the proteins and RNAs or snRNBs. And that U4, U6 complex is again finally bind, or it is bound to the concerned structure. So this is how the splicing mechanism, or the assembly of the spliceosome, occurs. And this is another representation or illustration where we have the GU and AG intron with an A, which is acting as the nucleophile, which is represented here. And now you can see that the U1 and U2 will bind, U1 at the 5' end and U2 at the nucleophile position. And it uses ATP, and energy of the ATP is used for this binding. And U1 is bound, U2 is bound. Then next step is the assembly of U5 at the 3' position, or here. Okay, this position, U5 is bound, and U4, U6 complex will bound. And finally, the entire spliceosome assembly, usually it is known as an inactive spliceosome, because after the binding of U1, U2, U5, U4, U6, all these snRNPs will create an inactive spliceosome, which is not actually functional in the, or it is not yet started working. And that inactive spliceosome will become active when additional ATP, with the energy expenditure of additional ATP, these U1 and U4 subunits will be, or that snRNPs will be released from the complex. U1 and U4 will be released, which actually makes the spliceosome complex an active one. So finally, initially all the U1, U2, U5, U4, U6, everything will bind and forms the inactive spliceosome complex. Then that finally, there is that structural change will bring together the different splice sites in the vicinity, and then U1 and U4 will be released out of that complex, which makes the spliceosome an active one. So that is the active spliceosome without the U1 and the U4. Then this lariat or the ring-like structure, which it is formed by a nucleophilic attack by the A on the G residue or the phosphate on the G residue here. So the 5' end of the intron is actually broken from the exon, and now a lariat or ring-like structure is actually formed. Then finally, you have this OH group which is attaching the AG or the 3' or 3' end of the intron is actually attacked by the 3' end of the or 3' end of the exon, and which is similar, it's an even just similar to the splice group 1 and group 2 type of intron splicing. So this step, the attack of or nucleophilic attack of this OH on the 3' end of the or 3' end of the intron is an event, just like that of the previous examples that is seen in case of a group 1 and group 2 splicing. So finally, the structure is released, this lariat-like structure of the introns along with the U5, U2 and U6 will be released, and these exons were now joined together, and that completes the spliceosome-mediated splicing. Okay, any doubts? Hello?
No.
No. Okay. I can show you a video right now. The RNA polymerase, which is moving along, producing the primary transcript. Now the green portion is the intron, and the yellow strand is the exomes, and the spliceosomes is assembling and bringing together the 3' and 5' end of the exons, and now it is spliced, and the exons were joined together by the spliceosome complex. So that's how it is. Of course. Okay, so this is the lariat of the introns along with the spliceosome is actually released. So this is the overall structure where we have one intron here, three different introns were present in the same primary transcript, and spliceosomal complex will bind to the different intron regions, and it is spliced and introns were released, and all the exons were joined together to form the final processed RNA. Okay. So this is another concept in which this splicing actually occurs along with the transcription or even before the completion of the transcription, so that there will be a point where the cap and the 5' end of the primary transcript is actually held to the RNA polymerase assembly, and only after the splicing this 5' end is released. So this provides a better mechanism for bringing together the 5' and 3' ends of the mRNA. So that you can see that since it is instead of releasing the mRNA during the transcription process, it is held tightly to the RNA polymerase at the 5' end. So during the transcription process, it is easy for the spliceosome assembly to bring together so that the intron units in the structure, and only after the splicing these final transcript is released from the mRNA assembly. So there's another concept. And here you can see this in our next stage, that is a polyadenylation, which is another post-transcriptional modification that is occurring in eukaryotic system. In polyadenylation, as you know, a poly-A, polyadenyl tail is attached at the 3' end or 3' end of the eukaryotic mRNAs. And here you can see the transcription assembly is here with RNA polymerase 2, and the primary transcript is produced here. And at the end or 3' end, or near the 3' end of the primary transcript, there will be a particular consensus sequence, and that sequence is AAU AAA. So that sequence, which is present in the case of all eukaryotic mRNAs, that consensus sequence marks the polyadenylation site. So in all the eukaryotic mRNAs, this poly A tail is attached, and the poly A site is actually marked with the consensus sequence AAU AAA, and there will be some more sequence downstream which will not be relevant or which is not required for the concerned final processed mRNA. So this is the polyadenylation site, which is actually marked with the consensus sequence AAU AAA. And now there is a CPSF factor. CPSF means cleavage and polyadenylation specificity factor. So that CPSF factor, cleavage and polyadenylation specificity factor, that will it is having two different activities. And one is the endonuclease activity, and another one is a poly-A polymerase activity. So this factor, which is it's a complex, which binds at the consensus sequences or the poly-A site, will have two different activities. One is endonuclease activity, and another one, poly-A polymerase activity. So this is the complex, polyadenylation complex, CPSF. And this is the endonuclease activity subunit. And there is another poly-A polymerase activity subunit, which polymerizes, which adds adenine units at the 3' end. So two activities were present in the CPSF complex. And this is the consensus sequences to which the CPSF will bind. So this is the mRNA and 3' end, okay? And now this is the remaining portion of the mRNA. And once the CPSF complex binds, then it will cleave the mRNA downstream. Downstream, the polyadenylation site. Polyadenylation site maybe after a few base pairs, after a short stretch of the base pairs, the mRNA strand will be cleaved by the endonuclease, and further adenine units will be added to the chain by poly-A polymerase. The endonuclease dissociates, and a new 3' or 3' end of the RNA is polyadenylated by the activity of poly-A polymerase. So this is a polymerase, poly-A polymerase enzyme, which is adding multiple ATP units or A units, which creates a poly-A tail at the 3' end of the eukaryotic mRNA. This is another representation. It's the same. So the, here we have the DNA template and polymerase 2, which is making or which is transcribing the primary transcript. This is the polyadenylation site AAU AAA. Now we have an CPSF factor or the enzyme complex which binds to that particular consensus sequence. Then it is making a break after a few base pairs, like 10 to 30 base pairs downstream of the poly-A site. You'll have a break which is created by the endonuclease activity of the CPSF. So this is about this length is about 10 to 30 base pair length downstream. That strand is broken. Now polyadenylate polymerase will add multiple A units at the end of that primary transcript, which creates a polyA tail, and the length of the polyA tail may be about 80 to 250 nucleotides long. So that is the approximate length of the polyA tail that is seen in case of eukaryotic systems. So this is how the polyA tail is added to the eukaryotic mRNAs. Okay, is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. Now this represents the overall or overview of the processing of the eukaryotic mRNAs. We can see that there is an ovalbumin gene which is represented, and in the ovalbumin gene we have about seven exon units were represented there, and six introns were also represented there, right? Six introns and seven exon units were represented in that ovalbumin gene. And during the transcription process, post-transcription process, or the RNA splicing, these intron units were supposed to be spliced off, and the exon, the seven intron units needs to be joined together to produce the final mature RNA. Okay, so here we have the gene, and this is the primary transcript with the different A, B, C, D, E, F, G introns. The seven introns are there, and all the seven introns were spliced off, and this is L is the leader region, then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, etc. All these are the exon regions, which is represented in green, and all the leader region and the seven exon units were joined together, and finally there is a polyA tail which is added here, and this one is a 5' cap. So this is how an mRNA, eukaryotic mRNA, or the primary transcript is processed. Now when we come to the processing, there are different types of splicing or alternative splicing mechanisms are there. Here are two different types of alternative splicing is actually marked. The first one is a alternative poly-A, polyadenylation sites. Let me show you how it works. In the initial diagram, we can see that there is a DNA with a 5' end here and a 3' end here. So the 5' end, or this may be an exon, and finally this is an intron. Okay, and here one possibility is that a poly-A site may be presented at two points in the primary transcript, instead of the poly-A site is AAU AAA. If that sequence is repeated two times near the 3' end of an mRNA, what happens? There is a possibility of splicing at this point or this point, resulting in two different mRNA finally, or mature mRNAs. Means either it can be spliced here and polyadenylated, or it can be spliced here and polyadenylated. So the first, in the first case, the shorter one will be this one, and in the second case, the longer one will be this one. So the length of the mRNA, the mature RNA, is actually dependent on where the poly-A, or which poly-A site is actually utilized for splicing. So that is one one of the methods of alternative splicing using different poly-A sites. And in the right side, you can see the 5' splice site is shown here. Here we have two 3' splice sites and a poly-A site. So here we have two 3 prime splice sites, which means this is either this white region can be considered as an intron and removed, or starting from the 5' splice site to the second 3' splice site, the entire length of these two segments can be considered as an intron and removed, which results in from the DNA, an RNA is produced, and during the splicing process, the intron is removed with the shorter fragment or with a longer fragment using two alternative 3' splicing sites. And that also results in two different final products. The result is that you have two different products, two different mRNAs, which may produce two different proteins at the end. So this is an example of two different alternative splicing mechanisms that is used. It can use alternative polyaggregation sites or alternative 3' splice sites. And this is not all. Here you can see alternative splice provides splicing provides for different mRNAs, which means you can have many types of mRNAs produced from the same primary transcript. Okay, so that doesn't mean that a single gene can produce a single product. When we come to the immunoglobulin diversity, you know that all the exons were shuffled and all the possible combinations of the antibodies were created using such a immunoglobulin from the immunoglobulin genes using such a splicing mechanisms and gene mix-ups. So from the single gene, you will have a lot of different mRNA products and concerned protein products which is produced using alternative splicing. So this is the same concept. So here we have an mRNA precursor with three different exons and two polyadulation sites that is represented as a mRNA precursor. So the first one is a selective splicing. Selective splicing means you are selectively joining different exons. So instead of joining the exons 1, 2, and 3 in sequence, you are joining together 1 and 2, leaving 3 behind. Sorry, or you are joining 1 and 3, leaving 2 behind, which results in a different mRNA, final mRNA product. Okay, so if you have, for example, in the previous case, we have 7 exons, you can join all of them together, or you can mix them up in different combinations. You can select any 4 of them and mix in any order. So it will create a different product. And that is one of the possibilities. They are known as selective splicing. And the next one is the alternative donor site, 5' donor site. So here we have one possibility, that is an exon is here with the 5' site. And this can be, for example, the 5' site may be this one or this one. Similar to the 3' alternative splice sites, you can have two different 5' splice sites also, which is present. So the 5' donor may be here or here, which results in different length in the final transcript length. And alternative 3' splice sites, for example, the 3' splice site may be this one or this one, which also results in difference in length. Alternative polyadulation site, which we already discussed. For example, this can be spliced here or here. Okay. If you have two different splice sites, it can be cleaved here or on the other one, on the second one. So using alternative donor sites or 5' donor sites or 3' acceptor sites or polyadulation sites, and even with selective splicing and joining together of the different exons, you will have a lot of possibilities in alternative splicing and making different combinations of the final mRNA from the same primary transcript. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, when we come to the bacterial system, Usually, the splicing is actually referred mainly in case of eukaryotic systems, where the RNA processing, including the 5' caps and poly A tail, all this, even the splicing of the introns, it is actually done in case of mainly in case of a eukaryotic system. It is not required in case of bacteria, because bacteria doesn't have a cap, it doesn't have a poly A tail, or the introns or intervening sequences are not present in the bacterial system. So that type of splicing mechanism is normally not required in bacteria. But in bacterial system also, there are some genes in which splicing processing of the primary transcript is required. And that's in case of the pre-mRNA transcripts in bacteria. Pre-rRNA transcripts. So the mRNA is ready to use in prokaryotes. So it starts translation along with the production, even before completion of the mRNA production. The available region of the mRNA will be the ribosomes will start translating the available region of the mRNA in prokaryotic systems. But in eukaryotic mRNAs, as you know, it needs to be processed. And final processed mature RNAs will only transported across the nuclear membrane to the cytoplasm for a translation. And in bacterial system, that is not the case. The mRNAs are ready to use. Such processing is not generally required. But RNA processing, if you are using the term RNA processing, that is required for a bacterial system also, where we have the case of pre-rRNAs or rRNA transcripts, which is actually coded as a cluster. Here you can see the pre-rRNA transcript 30S rRNA that is produced in a bacterial system. 30S actually combination of a 6S rRNA, 4S rRNA, 4S tRNA, and 23S rRNA and 5S rRNA. So collectively, it is actually called 30S primary transcript. And that needs to be processed to its separate RNAs like 16S, 23S, or 5S. And the first step is the methylation step. The pre-rRNAs in prokaryotic systems were methylated first. And after the methylation, then it is cleaved. And that cleavage is actually done by three different enzymes. That is RNase 3, RNase P, and RNase E. So three different enzymes were used for these cleavages. RNase 3, RNase P, and RNase E. And it is actually marked here. You can see that RNase 3, RNase P, and RNase E respectively, they cleave that primary transcript into four different fragments. And you have to also note that the RNase P is a ribosome. And a ribosome, as you know, it is an rRNA with enzymatic properties. Okay, so that's a ribosome, RNase P, it's well known. And anyway, these three different RNAs will cleave the primary transcript into four different units. Now, different nuclease enzymes will trim the ends. So you can see that the intermediate is having some unwanted regions at the ends. And that yellow region, which is marked at the ends, which needs to be further processed by different nuclease enzymes, which will trim at the end. And finally, the 6S rRNA, tRNA, 23S rRNA, and 5S rRNA were, or the mature RNAs were produced at the end in the prokaryotic system. So this is the processing of the pre-rRNA transcripts in bacteria. So first of all, there is a methylation of the primary transcript, then cleavage using RNase 3, RNase P, and RNase H. And finally, the concerned fragments were processed by the different nuclease enzymes or corresponding nuclease enzymes to remove the unwanted base pairs at the end, and the final structure of the concerned mature rRNAs would be, or RNAs and tRNAs would be produced in the end. So this is another representation where we have a ribosomal rRNA precursor of E. coli is represented. Here we have the 16S rRNA. This is a tRNA. This is a 23S rRNA. This is 5S rRNA. This is another tRNA. So it is something similar. All this, the same diagram is represented in another format. So where here we have RNASH and RNASP. All these enzymes will work on that one. So this is a single primary transcript is produced in E. coli. So different enzymes M16 and M5 or RNase 3, different M23, different enzymes will cleave at different positions to remove the unwanted regions. Now this is the processing of the pre-mRNA or pre-rRNA of vertebrates. Here we have 45S primary transcript, including the 18S, 5.8S, and 28S of a eukaryotic system. The first step is methylation, similar to the prokaryotic system, then the cleavage, and then the next one is the final processing of the unwanted regions, and final transcript is created. Here you can see that a series of enzymatic cleavages produces 18S, 5.8S, and 23S rRNAs. The cleavage reactions require RNAs found in the nucleolus, and they are called small nucleolar RNAs. SNO RNAs is required for the cleavage. So the final cleavage and processing is done by some of the RNAs present in the nucleolus, which is known as a nucleolar RNAs or rRNAs. And that RNAs will be used for the final cleavage and production of the mature rRNAs in case of eukaryotes. So this is about the processing of the pre-rRNA transcripts in vertebrates. So this is another example where the tRNA of bacteria and eukaryotes is produced. And as you know, here we have the tRNA which is represented or which is usually coded along with the rRNAs. So this is one rRNA, this is another rRNA, this is another rRNA. So tRNAs is actually coded along with the rRNAs in a single primary transcript. And that from the primary transcript, usually the RNASP and RNASH cuts will release the concerned rRNA. And also there are some other regions which needs to be removed in the final processed tRNA. And you can see that in the case of the tRNA, this is the anticodon arm. And in the case of anticodon arm, some of the regions or this region which is marked in yellow needs to be removed. So the RNAs P cut will remove the unwanted regions or extra regions in the 5'. RNAs D cut will remove the excess regions in the 3' or 3' CCA tail end. Then CCA addition. So there is a base modifications, 5' cleavage, 3' cleavage, and CCA addition. These are the basic steps that is occurring in tRNA production. So the first step, 5' cleavage is done by RNASP, 3' cleavage is done by RNASD, and CCA tail is added at the 3' end using another mechanism. Now, in every tRNA, there is a lot of modified bases which is present, pseudouridine, dihydrouridine, etc. You know there are various modified bases which is present in tRNAs. So that type of base modifications will be done, and finally the mature RNA with the additionally added CCA tail at the 3' end and modified bases, and finally the anticodon arm which is produced by removal of some of the excess regions where now finally produced, and now this is a mature RNA, mature tRNA in case of a eukaryotes and bacteria. In both cases, this will work. And now this is the final slide in which some of the modified bases, we discussed about modified bases in case of our tRNA, final tRNA production. So these are some of the modified bases that is used in case of such RNA or RNA production. And here you can see that there are cases where for thiouridine is used or inosine is used. Inosine, as you know, this is one of the base that is mainly contributing to the Wobble hypothesis or the degeneracy of the code. then this is about methyl 1-methyl guanosine, then isopentanyl adenosine, ribothymidine, pseudouridine, which is used in RNA, dihydrouridine, this is also used in tRNA. Both these items were used in tRNAs. So there are such modified bases which is used in different systems. And this is all about different types of splicing mechanisms and some of the modifications that is done in the case of primary transcripts in transcription.